gathered for your praise. Lift you high tonight, oh God.
Hey there, Prairie View. My name is Joshua, and it's my privilege to welcome you to worship this morning at Prairie View Christian Church. Whether you're able to gather in the room or whether you're joining us virtually, remotely, from a distance by the internet, we are glad that we can gather together as one people to worship the Lord together as a body in this place this week. It's January the 24th, and here are the welcome and announcements this week. If you're a visitor, a new face, or you've been here only a couple times before, we are glad that you've joined us this morning. You can find more information about the church at the website, pvcchurch.org, as well as ways to connect with us. For the purpose of this morning, we're going to be celebrating communion this week, which we do every week at Prairie View. If you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you're welcome to celebrate communion with us. We also collect an offering each week. Actually, you can use the mail at any point to send in an offering to the church. But communion we can only do here as we gather together. So that'll be later on in the service. We'll have offering and communion. Now, there's a couple of events and activities to bring to your attention. This coming Friday, the men's ministry will meet again, 7 o'clock at the church. They started John chapter 1 when they met a couple weeks ago. Couldn't possibly have finished John chapter 1. There's so much there. So continue your reading in John chapter 1. Come on in on Friday morning and they'll continue and eventually move on to John chapter 2. Also, we have one more Sunday in January, but then we'll have four Sundays in February of gathering food, non-perishable food, for the Hamilton County Harvest Food Bank. It's a food drive we do each year, typically in January, but we didn't do it in January this year. It'll be February. This is your warning. It's coming this coming Sunday, of course, January the 31st. I'm sure you can bring stuff in then, but the yellow barrels will show up for the four Sundays of February, so prepare for that. Now, speaking of not doing in January, we weren't sure whether we were going to be meeting in January. We have resumed full-time service indefinitely, although of course if you're not well, not feeling well, might have been exposed, stay home of course, we'll be doing live stream indefinitely as well. But we're paying attention to what our guidance is from the city, county, and state. If it turns out that this new British variant or whatever other variant comes along later is particularly nasty, then we may go back to being virtual again. We are not so concerned about what the death rate or the recovery rate is or isn't. We look at hospital capacity. We need people to be able to get treatment for ordinary stuff on top of the new stuff. So we don't want to be contributing to community spread in a way that it'll make it too hard for the hospital system to do its job. So if things get dicey again, we'll go back to being virtual again, but hopefully we'll be able to avoid that as we move forward, and we'll be in prayer about that. Other announcements, that's actually it for the announcements. We have a large number of items on our prayer list this morning. So I'll give us a scripture and then we'll hit that large list of items. And when you have a large list of items, sometimes it can be helpful to have a pattern to help guide your prayer. This morning I'm going to try, as we move through the prayer, to start small and local and then work outward from there geographically. It's just one pattern that some people have learned can be helpful to help organize and guide and focus the prayers. But first, scripture, Psalm 34, verses 11 through 18. Come, O children, listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. What man is there who desires life and loves many days that he may see good? Keep your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking deceit. Turn away from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. The eyes of the Lord are toward the righteous, and his ears toward their cry. The face of the Lord is against those who do evil, to cut off the memory of them from the earth. When the righteous cry for help, the Lord hears and delivers them out of all their troubles. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you that we can gather here as a local body to sing your praises, open your word, put it into practice, consider what it means for our lives, and how we can be walking more near to you and following you more closely today, in the days that come, and in generations to come. And thank you for the work of Ben, Zach, Mark, Chris, all the people who have worked hard to make this service possible, and their time in the Word and preparation to help us as a community. And Lord, thank you for the chance we've had this week to remember Sharon Fenimore, who we lost last year this week. And thank you for the memories that we have of her, and thank you that Joe and Jonathan and Sarah are here in this community in an ongoing way so that we can continue to be sorting through their grief with them, helping them with that, and helping them find new ways to serve you as their family looks different than it did a year ago. And thank you for the role this church has played in their lives. And thank you for the role that Sharon played in the lives of us, particularly the young people. Practically everybody in the building less than 15 years of age has been in her arms in the nursery. And thank you for the ministry that she provided for so long in that capacity. Lord, please be with those people locally who are making decisions and recommendations about the appropriate ways we should be responding to the virus and the vaccinations at the county level, the city level, and state and beyond. And I pray that we as a church can be part of the solution there and definitely not contributing to the challenge that our society faces. Lord, we've had a peaceful transition of power, at least as far as the last week has gone. Thank you for the leaders that you've given us. Thank you for the system of leadership that you've given us that we can look to every 4 or 8 years, an election, a transition of power. Thank you for the way that you have worked through the outgoing administration. Thank you in particular for the outspoken way that Vice President Pence was able to fulfill his responsibilities in a way that he went out of his way to give glory to you for the way that he did his work and look to you and your word for how he exercised his responsibilities. And thank you that we could look to him as a model of how to be a Christian and be in public service and be a politician in a way that gives credit to the name rather than disservice. And Lord, please be with the people who have come into power. Thank you for Vice President Harris and the way that she can model a whole new way of being a vice president. And thank you for all the boys and girls who can look to a female vice president and on the one hand see it as remarkable, on the other hand see it now as ordinary, and pray that she can do her work, her unique role within our republic in a way that is filled with wisdom from you and serves to give glory to you. And I pray that she would come to know you in a personal way so that she can do that consciously and intentionally. And Lord, please be with President Biden, who has probably the most taxing job in the world, and pray that he will be able to fill his role and fulfill his responsibilities with wisdom from you, that he will surround himself with advisors that are upright and honest and can give him good advice for the flourishing of our people. And please be moving in his life and in the life of people around him so that he can be making decisions and putting them into practice in a way that leads to the flourishing of our society and bring him into a relationship with you and as many people around him and his family and his advisors as possible. Thank you that there are Christians, Lord, at every level of society trying to honor you, and pray that can be the case at every level of government in an ongoing way. Lord, thank you that we can set aside a week each year to honor the memory of Dr. King and all those people from his generation, subsequent generations, and prior generations who shined a bright light on darkness in our society and issued a call for righteousness and justice and harmony. And I pray, Lord, that the church, our church and the church, can be serving that cause in an increasing way and never in any way stand in the way of racial reconciliation and harmony. And I pray that our church and every church can be a lighthouse in society to see how people of different complexions can work together for a much, much greater cause. And Lord, thank you that we can set aside a week each year to remember the dreadful court decision made in 1973 and all the efforts before and since then to stand up for the unborn and those who literally cannot speak for themselves. And I pray that while there is a role to play in that fight at the public policy level, and that's something that has taken a step backwards this week, Lord, I pray that the day will come when the decisions that are made in government are immaterial because the battle has been won at the heart level, relationship by relationship, one by one, that you'll be using this church and the church in America to help society understand the significance and specialness of human life, whether it's incredibly old or incredibly weak or not even born. I pray that we can help turn the tide towards righteousness in this country and that we can play a role there. Lord, there are many things on our mind and many things that can grieve us, but Lord, thank you that we come to you, the Lord of the universe, and know that eventually every wrong will be righted, every injustice will be set right, and that you are steering not this society, but your people your kingdom towards that great day when you rule again forever in righteousness and equity. And Lord, I pray that we can be remembering what it is that you're doing in our lives and in your people this morning and every morning. It's in your great name that we pray, Lord. Amen. Wow, I rotated.
'Well, good morning. Kids can come forward now if they feel so inclined and take a seat. In the course of Joshua's prayer, he mentioned President Biden having maybe the most taxing job, and not to make light of that, but it struck me that churches across at least the United States right now, the tech people have also a very hard, difficult job with Joshua's thunderstorm airplane sound that was coming through the speakers, cameras dropping out, all the goofy things that are happening, and it's surely not just happening here, but tip of the cap to them, because yeah, they don't get recognized. They're like referees, right? When you notice them, it's bad. You never notice them when everything is going well. So tip of the cap to our tech people, including Joshua. Good morning. What is your heart for? Do you know what your heart is for? What's your heart for? For love? That's a great answer. Mm-hmm. Well, your heart is part of your body, and it pumps blood. It moves blood through your body, okay? But you're right. The heart is also for love. Has anyone ever told you that they love you with all their heart? Yeah, has someone ever told you that? Have you ever heard that you're supposed to love God with all of your heart? You've heard that too? What does that mean? Do you know what it means to love somebody with all of your heart? Yeah? What does it mean? That's a great answer. To not make God mad. That is, if we all could do that a little better. Your heart is what makes you, you, right? You keep special memories in your heart. You keep your favorite things in your heart. Being happy, sad, or even mad all come from your heart. The things you like the most and the things you don't like the most, those are things you keep in your heart too. So, the heart's pretty important, right? Your heart is important. Yes, because again, your heart holds everything that makes you, you. How you treat other people, how you feel, everything you do is guided by your heart, which means you need to take care of it. Now, how would you feel if I told you that your heart was broken? There was something wrong with your heart. How would you feel? Sad? Right. It's a little sad. It's a little scary, right? We should be a little worried if we found out our heart was broken, if there was something wrong with it, because that would mean that everything we do, everything that makes us who we are, there's something broken about it. And that's what the Bible tells us. God's word tells us that each one of us has a broken heart. There's something wrong with our hearts. Because of sin, our hearts don't work right, and they need fixed. Now, fortunately, God is strong enough to fix our hearts. And while our hearts are broken, we will continue to make mistakes. But little by little, God fixes our hearts when we follow Jesus, until one day our hearts will be made perfect like him. In the Bible, Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 says this. It says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your paths straight." In your box today, you might have found a jumble of papers with hearts on it. What that is a heart puzzle for you to piece together and glue to your construction paper as a way to remind you to remember that it's okay to follow your heart as long as you've given your heart to Jesus. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for These children sitting here in front of me, thank you for the other children in this room. Thank you for the children who are tuning in from their homes via screens, wherever that might be. Lord, thank you for our hearts. Thank you for the life you've given to us, that you didn't put us here on this earth in a gray, boring, dull existence, but you've given us life, you've given us joys and emotions and pleasures and things to love. Help us to give our hearts to you, God, to love what you love, hate what you hate, and do the things that you would have us do. Help us as a church to train these young children in that, that they would see us loving the things you love, and that they would also learn to love the things that you love as they watch us and as they follow our example. God, help us to know that you're good and beautiful and amazing and worthy of our love, that it's not something we have to force, it's not something we have to cook up, but the more we look to you, the more we think about what Jesus did, how he died for us, how he came to this earth, lived a perfect life, and died for us while we were his enemies, that would fill our hearts with a love for you that would burn and never grow old or fade or go away. Thank you for the church. Thank you for the way that you've given us each other to encourage our love for you, to shape our hearts amid all the distractions, all the things pulling us in different directions. Help us as a church to build up one another, to build up the body, that we might look more and more like you, until one day our hope is that we will be made perfect and we will be with you and we will see you in glory. Thank you for Sunday mornings. Thank you for the way you've given us time to set aside to worship you, to love you, to pursue you, and hopefully point our hearts back to you. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thanks.
Well, good morning, Prairie View Christian Church. My name is Chris Ernst, and I'm an elder in training here at Prairie View. As an elder, one of the responsibilities is to give the communion meditation. This is my first time giving the meditation, so I hope you'll provide me with a little bit of grace. Now, last week, Joshua gave the communion meditation from his car. This week, I am giving it from my basement. No, we are not having a competition as to the most unique places that we can give communion meditations from. Just so happens that, unfortunately, my family and I are not able to join everyone in worship this morning. So while it can be a blessing on one hand because I can do this in as many takes as I need to, I certainly would have preferred to have been there live. I'm going to talk a little bit about communion and what it has meant to me over the years, and I'm hoping that something I say may resonate or you may find relatable as we look at communion. Over the years, I've looked at communion very seriously. When I was younger, for some reason, I would tell you that it would intimidate me when we would take communion. I grew up in the Methodist church, so we didn't do it every single week. It was more like twice a year. And when it did happen, I was more focused on making sure I didn't drop the wafer or spill the juice. Wanted to make sure that I passed the tray properly to either a family member or whoever was sitting in the pew next to me. Once it was done, I'll be honest, I was happier to see it come to an end. I felt the stress actually leave my body. Now, maybe I'm taking things too seriously, but I think communion is an important part of what we do as Christians. So once my wife and I, after we were married and we had our first child, we decided to move to a different church that took communion on a monthly basis. Now, this was a completely different experience and situation. So instead of a cup and a wafer, we had a loaf of bread at the front of the sanctuary where we'd be dismissed each week, and you'd walk up in a single file line and you would pull a piece of bread from the loaf and then you'd dip it in the cup as you walked past the pastor. Well, this created a completely different level of anxiety, and at first it was, gosh, am I how big of a chunk ended up coming out. Am I playing tug of war with the pastor? I don't want to dip too much because I didn't want the bread to be soggy. People would walk back to their seats. Some would put it in their mouth immediately. Some would wait until they got to their chair and would pray on it. I'll tell you, for me, it was one of those things that, again, I was focused on the act, the process. But as time went on and my faith grew, I realized just how important communion is. I realized I was focusing way too much on the act and not as focused on the meaning of communion. Well, Jesus tells us in Matthew 26 all about communion. In verses 26 through 28, they read, "Now as they were eating, Jesus took bread, and after blessing it, broke it, and gave it to the disciples, and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body.' And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, 'Drink of it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins.'" Now, Jesus didn't say, "Hey, don't take too much bread. Careful, don't spill the wine." He explained what communion was and what it was for and what it represented. Well, Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 11, verses 27 and 28, "Whoever, therefore, eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup." Well, Paul's telling us that we should be examining ourselves during communion. So communion should be taken seriously. It's an important part of being a follower. Every time we take communion, we tell the world what we believe. Communion brings us together, like Joshua said last week. I don't know if you can relate to my experience of being more concerned about the process, or maybe you've come up to the table and you see the cup and it doesn't remind you of bread. The various thoughts that go through your head. But instead of focusing on those things, let's focus on what the meaning is. And the meaning is that the bread represents Jesus's broken body, and the juice is his blood shed on the cross for our sins. That's what we should be focusing on. Examine yourself, as Paul says. Now, communion is for believers. So if you're visiting with us this morning, you don't need to be a member of Prairie View Christian Church, but you do need to be a follower of Christ. And if you're not a follower, please take this time, explore your faith, reach out to us. We'd love to talk to you more about what that means and what that looks like. Also, I do want to remind everyone that on each of the tables, there is a box for your offering. Again, if you're here visiting with us this week, we don't expect you to provide an offering, but certainly you are welcome to if you feel led. Ask now at this time that you join me in prayer as we prepare our hearts and our minds for communion. Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for this church. Thank you for your son Jesus and for him dying on the cross for our sins. Thank you for him reminding us through communion what that means and what that looks like. Lord, we've all, I'm sure, been guilty at one time or the other just taking communion as something that we do. But instead, we need to think of it as much more meaning and much more than a ritual, but truly understand what communion means to each and every one of us and us as followers. Father, we are so thankful for the ability to do this here at Prairie View Christian Church in Fishers, Indiana, and to be in a country that allows us to do this freely. So Father, again, we thank you for this time this morning. We thank you for your son, Jesus, and it's in his name we pray. Amen. At this time, please feel free to come up and to partake in the elements. Thank you.
Well, good morning, and welcome again to Prairie View Christian Church. We appreciate you joining us here in the room and online as well. Now, today is week 4 of our Problematic Proverbs sermon series, and for those who haven't been here the past few weeks, the idea is that we are examining common sayings of cultural wisdom with both an affirming and a critical eye. We're affirming the good parts of these sayings that can be accepted by believers in Jesus, while also being honest about the bad parts that we Christians may do well to reject. So in week 1, we discussed the phrase, "You only live once." Week 2 was, "The Lord helps those who help themselves." And last week was, "If you don't have something nice to say, don't say anything at all." So with all three of these sayings, we've tried to pick out the meat and leave the bones. We'll do the same thing this morning with our fourth problematic proverb, and that phrase is this: follow your heart. Follow your heart. So open your Bibles to Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. That'll be one of the last passages that we read this morning. But if there's one piece of scripture you take away from this sermon, it might be the best one. So Proverbs 3, verses 5 and 6, feel free to follow along as we go. We'll have verses on the screen as well. But before we go any further, let's pray. Father, again, thank you for this day. Thank you for this time that we've had together. Thank you for the opportunity to worship you. And as Joshua mentioned in his opening prayer, it's been a big week, both in the life of our nation and even the life of this church, looking back on what's happened in the past and looking ahead to what the future could hold. And so, Lord, we lift up all those requests to you. We lift up these people to you. Lord, I ask you to continue to watch over our church in this season that we're in. You have taken such great care of us over this past year, especially with all the chaos, but we ask you to continue doing that as hopefully we get a little bit closer to the end of this crisis that we're in. Thank you for providing for us as a church. I pray that we would be good stewards of all you've given to us and that you'd continue to meet our needs. Lord, I pray that you would unify us as a church, even though we're more scattered than we typically would be and more out of touch than we would like to be. I pray that you would unify us as brothers and sisters in Christ. And I pray that you would sanctify us, grow us in holiness and maturity. Let the crucible of this time that we're in, the pressure, the heat, the hardship of 2020 and 2021, I pray that it would grow us and shape us in ways that might be painful now, but ultimately are good for us in the long run. And I pray that our worship today would be honoring to you. I pray that for the sermon. I pray that for the music we'll hear after the sermon, that everything we do and say here at this church today would be not just good for us, but would be honoring to you. We love you. We worship you. We ask this all in Christ's name. Amen. Well, we've got a lot to discuss this morning, so let's jump right in. What wisdom might we find in the phrase, follow your heart? Well, first, this saying rightly acknowledges that there is something special, something unique, something even a bit mysterious about the human heart. In its most basic and technical sense, your heart is a blood pump. It distributes blood throughout the rest of your body. But deep down, we know that our hearts, while they are incredibly important organs in just the physical sense, the heart is not just another organ. There's a reason nobody says, follow your kidney, or follow your gallbladder, or follow your liver. There's something different, something bigger, something deeper, something more significant going on in the human heart besides just pumping blood. Those in the ancient world, the world in which the Bible was produced, recognized this. The heart was considered the all-encompassing seat of one's identity, personality, intellect, memory, emotions, desire, and will. While ancients may not have known as much about the heart or the brain as we do in the technical sense, they still knew it was important. And they were right. The Bible recognizes the importance of the heart as well. In fact, you might be surprised if you sat down and really studied, really considered just how often the Bible talks about hearts. We read in Genesis chapter 6, verse 5. The Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intention of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. This is a really big, thick book, and you only have to read the first 6 chapters before you already see God talking about hearts and the corruption of human hearts. But then you also read a passage like Exodus 35, verse 29. This is when the Israelites are wandering in the desert outside of Egypt. They are building the tabernacle, which was basically the portable temple where they would worship. We read there, all the men and women, the people of Israel, whose heart moved them to bring anything for the work that the Lord had commanded by Moses to be done, brought it as a free will offering to the Lord. So in Genesis, we read that our hearts are sinful. In Exodus, we see that our hearts are involved in the act of worship. We're already seeing that our hearts are pretty complex. Deuteronomy chapter 6, one of the most important passages in the entire Old Testament, commands the newly redeemed nation of Israel to love the Lord your God with all your heart. David is described as a man after God's own heart. And he's anointed king over Israel, not because he was impressive on the outside, but because the Lord looks on what? The Lord looks on the heart. Some of the Old Testament's grandest promises revolve around our hearts. Jeremiah 31 promises that someday God's disobedient people would have God's law written on their hearts, and that in that day they would finally obey. We read another passage, Ezekiel 36. It promises that God's stubborn people will be given new hearts that love God rather than hard hearts that rebel against him. Jesus himself talks about the heart frequently. Where your treasure is, there your heart is also. We read Matthew 12 last week, where Jesus says, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. In Acts chapter 2, those who hear the Apostle Peter preach about Jesus' death and resurrection repent of their sin and are baptized. They did so because when they heard that sermon, they were cut to the heart. And finally, Romans chapter 10, another passage that we mentioned briefly last week. The Apostle Paul writes that if one believes in his heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, he will be saved. It's all over the place in the Bible. That's just a quick sampling of some of the most well-known examples. The point is that you don't have to be an ancient philosopher. You don't have to be a student of Scripture to know there's something special about the heart. Humans seem to intuitively understand this. I mean, just think of all the other sayings that we use. When we're burnt out, we may say, you know, my heart's just not in it. When we get dumped, we say that they broke my heart. When we're uncertain about something, we say, I know it in my head, but I just don't feel it in my heart. So one good thing that comes from this problematic proverb, follow your heart, is that it rightly recognizes that the human heart isn't just for pumping blood. There is something meaningful there, even if it doesn't show up in an x-ray, a CAT scan, or an MRI. It's hard to explain, but we know it's true. Second, this saying, follow your heart, may have some merit to it when it comes to decision-making. In some ways, it's similar to other sayings that we know. Sayings like, trust your gut, or listen to your conscience. There may really be something to trusting your gut. A recent article in Scientific American reports that there is an often overlooked network of neurons lining our guts, so extensive that some scientists have nicknamed it our second brain. That's why I try to keep mine just a little bit bigger than necessary. More brain power. The point is that in a way we don't fully understand, there could be some healthy, God-given instincts buried in our guts. There may be something to listening to your conscience as well. The Apostle Paul takes the conscience of believers quite seriously. He talks about it in the book of Romans, book of 1 Corinthians. Thomas Aquinas, one of the most important theologians who ever lived, defined the conscience as a man's judgment of himself according to God's judgment of him. He said it was part of our practical reason. And as the Protestant reformer Martin Luther was commanded to recant his writings against the corruption of the Roman Catholic Church in his day and age, he refused, and he said this, my conscience is captive to the word of God, for to go against conscience is neither right nor safe. Martin Luther listened to his conscience. He followed his heart. He trusted his gut. And as a result, he changed the church and change the world for the better. So there really is some good that can come from following your heart. It's more than just a blood pump. And following it, or on a related note, trusting your gut, listening to your conscience, might really be helpful in making decisions that aren't clearly laid out in Scripture. It may help you wisely avoid danger. It may help you practice discernment in assessing really difficult situations. It may help you find passions and gifts and skills unique to you that you enjoy, that you're good at, that you care about, and that you can use for God's glory. Not everyone is cut out for every difficult thing in this world, and that's okay. We all have different personalities. We all have different gifts. But there are things in this world that are really, really hard, that are really, really messy, that really need to be done. And sometimes you need to find the right person, the one who has a special heart for it, if it's going to be done well. And praise God that He has created those people. But, and you knew this part was going to come, there are also problems with this proverb. So what can go wrong with this phrase, follow your heart, if we take it too far? Well, following our hearts can go wrong when we assume that our hearts, or our guts, or our consciences, are always perfect guides. Remember what we read from Genesis chapter 6, verse 5. God assessed humanity as having sin in our hearts. And remember those Old Testament promises to God's people, how someday He would write His law on their hearts and even give them new hearts. Well, that seems to imply that something is wrong with the old ones. One of the most important biblical passages on the human heart is Jeremiah chapter 17, starting in verse 9. God says, speaking through Jeremiah, "The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately sick. Who can understand it? I, the Lord, search the heart and test the mind to give every man according to his ways, according to the fruit of his deeds." In Romans chapter 1, verses 18 through 23, Paul describes humanity's sinful hearts as foolish and darkened. He says in 1 Timothy 4, verse 2, Titus chapter 1, verse 15, that there are false teachers out there whose consciences are seared, whose consciences are defiled. As sinners, our hearts, our guts, they're not just imperfect guides. They can be deceptive, and they can even be destructive guides. Christians throughout history have warned that our hearts are not sufficient guides for life in and of themselves. Augustine famously said that human hearts are restless until they find their rest in God. Restless until they find their rest in God. Missing something. Incomplete apart from God. He went on to argue that our hearts need to be reformed by God's grace because they naturally go in the wrong direction. They need to be pointed in the right direction towards God if they're going to be worth following. It's only when our hearts are changed by God and directed toward God that the right words and the right actions will follow. Theologian John Calvin argued that a sense of deity, a sense of God's existence, is indelibly engraved on the human heart. That could be his way of referring to our conscience. We just have this innate sense of right and wrong that doesn't seem to go away even if we believe or don't believe in God. But the problem is that these consciences, our hearts, our guts, are corrupted by sin. That's why the Puritan pastor Richard Baxter advised this to believers. He said, "Make not your own judgments or consciences your law or the maker of your duty. There is a dangerous error grown too common in the world that a man is bound to do everything which his conscience tells him is the will of God, and that every man must obey his conscience as if it were the lawgiver of the world. But indeed, it is not ourselves, but God that is our lawgiver. An erring conscience is not to be obeyed, but to be better informed. Our hearts are only reliable insofar as, like Martin Luther, they are captive to the word of God. Our hearts must be changed by God's grace through faith in Jesus Christ, shaped and molded by the Holy Spirit before they are worth following. So contrary to the message of many of the most famous Disney movies, following your heart isn't always a good idea. Sometimes it can lead you astray. Adolf Hitler is rightly considered history's greatest villain. And how did he get there? He followed his sinful heart. He trusted his gut. He listened to his conscience. And it led him down some absolutely horrible paths. How many times have we heard stories of a man or a woman leaving a spouse and leaving a child to have an affair because they followed their heart? In both cases, you cannot question the person's sincerity. But sincerity is not enough if you are sincerely wrong. Following your heart is not wise. And it can even destroy you and destroy others if your heart is corrupted by sin and untouched by God's grace. So while the saying isn't necessarily all bad, it's not necessarily all good either. You're correct to sense that your heart is more than just a blood pump. And there may be something to be said for trusting your gut or listening to your conscience as you make some decisions and pursue some interests, some passions, some skills. But be careful, because left to itself, your heart is not infallible. In and of itself, it is fallen, and thus it is an insufficient guide. But thankfully, there is a solution to this problem for sinners. When we understand the deception, the sickness, the restlessness that our hearts have fallen into, we cry out to God to transform our hearts by his grace, inform them by his word, and shape them by his spirit. We see David do that in Psalm 51, starting in verse 10. This passage is written after David has committed a heinous sin. He's destroyed people around him. He's destroyed his family. In a way, he's even destroyed himself. But David says in Psalm 51, verse 10, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me." Verse 17, he says, "The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise." When we see our hearts for what they really are, deceived, desperately sick, foolish, darkened, restless, when we repent of our sin and ask God to save us, he does. We repent of our sin and ask him to save us, knowing that God himself has a heart for sinners. So much so that he sent his son Jesus Christ to die in our place. We read in Hebrews 10, verse 22, that it's thanks to who Jesus is, it's thanks to what Jesus has done, that we can draw near to God with a true heart and full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience. It's because of who Jesus is and what Jesus has done that we can be reconciled to God, that we no longer have to be subject to the tyranny of our sinful hearts, but instead following the one who has redeemed them. Look at Psalm 24, starting in verse 3, another Psalm of David. David says, "Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord? And who shall stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not lift up his soul to what is false and does not swear deceitfully. He will receive blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek the face of the God of Jacob." In us, we do not have what it takes to ascend the hill of the Lord. Because we have followed our sinful hearts, we are unworthy of standing in his presence on our own. But Jesus is worthy. Jesus is uncorrupted by sin the way you and I have been. He's the possessor of a heart of perfect love, perfect unity, and perfect obedience to the Father, the kind of heart that you and I don't have. And by faith in his sacrificial death on the cross, by faith in his victorious resurrection, we can be one with him. We can ascend the hill of the Lord. We can stand in God's eternal presence with pure hearts. As we close that final passage, Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6, perhaps one of the most well-known portions of the book of Proverbs. "Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make straight your paths." We trust God with our hearts, but we do not follow them or lean on them for understanding. We don't have to look inward for wisdom and truth and meaning. We don't have to look inward for all the answers to life's problems. We look upward at the God who we can now call our Father. And until we do that, our hearts will be restless. They'll be deceived. They'll be desperately sick. They'll be foolish and darkened until they find their rest in him. There's something better out there than following your heart. Something far more reliable than following your heart. And that's following Christ, looking to the God we can now call our Father, trusting him, not trusting ourselves. Let's pray. Father, thank you for, again, this day, this opportunity to worship you. And on the one hand, it's hard to read scripture that gives us an honest assessment of our hearts. We're often taught to look at our hearts as pure and wise and always knowing the right thing and always having the right instincts and always pursuing the right objects, but it's simply not the case. But Lord, thank you that in the same scripture where we read about the sorry state of our hearts and of ourselves, we also have these promises that you've given us to help our hearts, to heal our hearts, to change our hearts, to give us new hearts that love you and worship you. The kinds of hearts that will actually produce joy, that will actually produce meaning, will actually produce truth rather than counterfeits and fool's gold. And so, Lord, help us to love the right things. Help us to know the right things, want the right things, desire the right things, care about the right things. And again, that can only happen if you change our hearts. We thank you that you have done that so much when people place their faith in Jesus Christ. We can think of so many examples of people who you talk to them and their hearts are just different than they ever were before. And it's because you've changed them. It's because you've justified them. It's because you've matured them. And so, Lord, I pray that for those of us who do believe in you, that you would continue maturing our hearts and helping our hearts look more like yours. And for those who don't know you, Lord, I pray that they would take advantage of the offer that you give, that they too can have new hearts new minds, new lives by faith in Jesus Christ. Lord, thank you that we are not condemned and resigned to sin and punishment and judgment and condemnation, but that you have a heart for sinners and that you save us through your Son. So, Lord, help our hearts find rest as we find rest in you. We love you, we worship you, we ask this all in Christ's name. Amen. Let's stand together as we sing.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord.
To hear, because then once you hear it, you can go about the work of healing or surgery or recovery, all that kind of stuff that can only happen when you've heard the bad news. And so this morning we've heard some bad news about our hearts, that they're deceived and desperately sick and foolish and darkened. But again, thankfully, thanks be to God, we have a good physician. We have a healer in the God who has a heart for sinners. So if you have questions about what it means to place your faith in Christ, what it means to follow Christ rather than following your heart all the time and letting your heart and your gut and your conscience be shaped by the Word of God, be shaped by the Holy Spirit, please talk to us. We would love to pray with you, love to answer your questions, love to have those conversations, and even welcome you into this community of believers who have hearts that we hope, we pray, we intend are being shaped and formed by God. None of our hearts are perfect. They won't be this side of heaven. But we look forward to the day when we will stand in God's presence with pure hearts. And we trust and we know that God is preparing us for that day even as we speak. So if you have questions about that, again, please talk to us. We'd love to talk more. But I'll close our service in prayer. We hope you have a great rest of the week. We hope you'll be here next week as well, either in the room or online. And we do ask that you make your way out of the building. Don't hang around inside too much longer than you have to. So with that, I'll close us in prayer. Father, again, thank you for this day. Thank you for the bad news that our hearts are messed up. But Lord, thank you for the good news that you are the good physician. And you can heal us. You can help us. You can raise us from the death that sin brings about and raise us into new life with Christ. And so, Lord, I pray that you would do that. I pray that every single day as followers of Christ, you would be continuing that work of shaping us and forming us from the inside out. And Lord, thank you that you are such a better master than our hearts and our guts and our consciences. They may help us from time to time. They may help us make some good decisions here and there. But at the end of the day, you are a far better master than our hearts, than our guts, than our consciences. And so, Lord, I pray that you would help us to serve you with joy and trust that you are leading us in the right places. And God, give us the faith to look to you for the answers that we need rather than looking in ourselves. Thank you for the opportunity to worship you this morning. Thank you for these people. I pray it's been good for us, but most of all, we pray that it's been honoring to you. We love you. We ask this all in Christ's name. Amen. Have a great week.
Strength.